like to let's give the music a big hand. I'd like to welcome all of you to the 2001 Chamber of Commerce Annual Banquet. We're going to get started this evening with our dinner, and before we eat, I'd like to have Pastor Ken Kent of the First United Methodist Church give the invocation.
Shall we pray? Blessed art thou, O God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. We are thankful for our community. We're thankful for the chance that we have to better ourselves, to better the city, to better all who live here through our involvement in business and commercial and civic activities. Be with us tonight as we celebrate this past year. We pray that you would be the unseen guest at our meal, the silent listener to our conversations. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Kent. What we'd like to do is to, for the meal this evening, the staff has instructed me that they would like to have us leave through the second set of double doors there on my left. And since I'm in charge here, I get to pick who goes first. Although Bob Phipps has given me instructions that the chamber staff needs to go close to first. So I think to probably make this simple, we'll have the head table go first, and then we'll just go across in rows, starting with the first row of tables here and then following all the way back. Sorry, Jay. It's one of the hazards of giving up the MC position. Tough luck. Next year. So we're going to go ahead and get started with the meal then.
Thank you.
I have your attention? Is this on? Okay, it is. Who said that? I'd like to welcome everybody to this year's Chamber of Commerce Annual Banquet. This is the time we celebrate our community and our quality of life that is enhanced and promoted by the Fairfield Area Chamber of Commerce. It's also a time for us to reflect on the events of the year 2000 and to look forward to the developments and events of the year 2001. Before we get started, I would like to recognize a couple of our dignitaries in the audience. I believe here this evening we have Fairfield Mayor Bob Rasmussen. And we also have present Supervisor Mike Pesch. Mike? I didn't see any other elected official, county or city here, so, okay. I would like to reflect a moment on this past year. Of course, the year started with the absolute biggest non-event in world history, and that was the Y2K debacle. And this, of course, led to the world's largest portable generator garage sale in history. These generators, of course, were all new, in their boxes, never opened, and were for sale at very, very cheap prices. Evidently, the countless dollars that were spent on the Y2K problem were well spent because we really didn't have a problem except for one. And that was the Y2K problem caused by those organized folks who years earlier, planning for their own demise, managed to go out and purchase grave headstones and then authorize the monument companies to carve the numbers 1 and 9 on the face of those stones. Sorry, sorry mistake they made. And that was evidently something the Y2K folks couldn't overcome. And of course, this year there have been some real interesting events around the Chamber of Commerce. As you know, Bev Nelson, a person who's never happy, person who's always in a bad mood. Bev assumed the president's chair. And in spite of the challenges faced by the chamber staff trying to locate her during the workday, she proved herself to be a real live wire. Okay. I know that was really kind of weak. But I'm really trying my best not to make Jay Silverman's MC performances look bad. And of course, he was the MC the past few years. You know, for those of you that don't know, Jay's psyche's been rather fragile these last few weeks. Not only has he recently had live wire problems of his own at J&B Plastics that caused the power in the northwest part of town to be shut down, but he's also taken some abuse from the Des Moines Register. I don't know how many of you looked at yesterday's Des Moines Register. It's a metro in Iowa, it's Section B. I mean, can you imagine waking up in the morning, opening up your register, and seeing the storyline that says, "Nothing can save dumb Silverman." It's right there, page 5B. So please, please be kind to Jay. And of course, any comments about the year 2000 would be incomplete without remembering the term that none of us recognized 12 months ago, but now a term that all of us know, Chad. I'm not talking about you, Chad, huh? Who in their wildest dreams ever thought that the world's most technologically sophisticated advanced nation would have its voting process brought down by pregnant, hanging, and dimpled Chads? Nationally, we have had recounts and appeals to the courts. But here in Jefferson County, we had our own replay. Not satisfied with the results of the June primary in the supervisor's race, we had our own replay in November. And of course, no review of calendar year 2000 from me would be complete without giving you the following numbers to ponder. Those numbers are 71 and 12. You're probably asking yourself, what's the significance of those numbers? Well, those numbers represent the combined win-loss record of the Iowa State University Cyclone men's and women's basketball teams and the ISU football team for contests in the year 2000. It was definitely the year of the Cyclones. I know, it's kind of hard for some to take, but I've never had this opportunity before. Before moving on to the program, I think a couple of comments regarding our upcoming year would also be appropriate. This year's chamber president is Jody Kerr. As Jody served as an ex officio member of the FIDA board last year, I had an opportunity to see her in action. Jody will be an excellent president. She's full of ambition, energy, she's organized, and she's very conscientious. But perhaps there's one thing about Jody that you don't know. I didn't know it either, but a lot of her friends made sure I did. As many of you do know, Jody's husband, Mickey, loves stock cars, building and racing stock cars. But unfortunately, he is not the one in the family with the lead foot. I would like to take this time before we get into the program to do a couple of housekeeping things. This year we had some businesses that stepped forward and were sponsors of some tables and sponsors of the banquet. They are TD&T Financial Group, KMCD, Kick96RadioVillage.com, and KYOU Fox 15. So I'd like to have you give them a hand. And then also, I did find out one other bit of information. Evidently, tomorrow is the 23rd wedding anniversary for Deb and Chris Davis. So if you'd stand, we'd give you a hand. Moving into the program this year to present the Ambassador of the Year Award, Larry Smith.
Thank you, Greg. Well, here I am again, and the ambassadors keep thinking that I'm the one that should give this speech each year, but we're not putting that in the bylaws, okay? Kind of continuing with Craig's speech a little bit, we are in the 22nd century, so I just happened to get this on the internet today, and so I thought maybe I'd share a little bit of it with you. You know that you're in the sign of this 22nd century when you try to enter your password on your microwave. You haven't played solitaire with real cards in years. You have at least 15 phone numbers to reach your family of three. Sign of the times. Okay, without any further ado, I'm going to jump right into this. The ambassadors have been pretty busy this year. We've had 57 visits, events, and meetings. A lot of businesses around town, Visions Investment Services, Granny's Attic, Red Rock Tavern, Lifeson Redemption Center. I could go on down through this list, but I won't. And my job is to get to my speech. Here we go. What is an ambassador? Well, some of us out there and a lot of people that know us probably think that we are the good time party people. We have a pretty good time. We love our little social events, and we love when we get to go to these meetings because we have a good time seeing each other and welcoming people to the community. And really, we're kind of the first line of defense for the Chamber of Commerce because we're a lot of the new businesses that are coming into play. We're the welcome committee. In 2000, the millennium year, like I said, we had 57 visits, new businesses, events, and meetings. An Ambassador of the Year is always selected for somebody who has some outstanding achievement, mostly who can attend most of these events. But one important thing I want to say about it is that It seems like for the last couple of years, the ambassador, you know, is somebody who's very energetic, very outgoing, has a gracious smile, and is always willing to welcome somebody. So without any further ado, let's put our hands together again for Sharon Workman for the second year in the row for a gracious lady on Ambassador of the Year.
I guess I did overlook a couple of our elected officials, and I'll probably hear about it for a long time. There are a couple city council members here, Mr. Gookin, Mr. Thompson. Did I miss anybody else? Polly? Polly? Oh, sorry. You're just too close. Next, we have John Hammes. John is vice president of the Fairfield Economic Development Association. He's going to report to you on the year 2000 in FITA. John.
Good evening. Thank you, Craig. Isn't email wonderful? I had been out of town most of this week, and I got back in Thursday, and Thursday afternoon, Dave Reef called me, and he said, John, have you checked your email lately? I said, no, I haven't had a chance to, but here it is. From Reef Green, Thursday, February 8th, 2001, 11:54 a.m. John, hi, I'll call you soon. In fact, see if you'll speak a few words for FITA. I didn't call earlier because staff said that you hadn't registered yet, and I assumed you were out of town. I, in fact, had a program today that I wasn't sure I was going to be finished with in time. I'm including the presidential letter, which I released for the handout. And all I ever do is introduce the board, the ex officios, locate them before you stand so you don't miss any, especially the mayor. Thank them for their time and the dedication and their effort. Then recap what we feel is important for right now and move on. As guests of the chamber, I really think it's best of the evening because the evening gets long enough. So talk fast. Thanks, Dave. So, keeping in line with what the president says, first, I'd like to introduce the board. Craig Foss. Dick Smith. Dick's out here. Stand up, Dick. And I guess absent this evening are Roy Self is not able to be with us this evening. Pete Nelson is absent this evening, as well as Ross Walker. And then our ex officio members, John Morrissey, over here, serves our legal counsel, Tom Thompson. One other ex officio that comes that we have on our board that just joined us here recently is Jim Pedrick also, because as the president-elect of the Chamber of Commerce, the president-elect sits with us on the FITA board also. And we just, Jody Kerr, as Craig said, served with us last year, and Jim has joined us now for 2001. We'd like to appreciate their efforts also. Thanks, Jim. So, congratulations to all the honorees of tonight's Business Improvement Awards, and a big thanks to the four new building owners and occupants in our Business Industrial Park. This is a real show of confidence in our city that will generate many years or even decades of additional commerce for the Fairfield area. Many new housing starts and additions or expansions of existing housing areas further underscore the fact that Fairfield is moving in a positive direction and will continue to grow. Although we are trying to make better use of what we have to work with, like the Malibu Reclamation Project, we have a shrinking land inventory and will need to bolster the supply to have plenty of land on our shelves to show prospective newcomers to Fairfield. We think our city will soon need to annex land in the projected growth areas consistent with its strategic plan. We believe progress on land procurement for the US 34 bypass and the Fairfield Runway Extension Project clearly certifies Fairfield as one of the few cities in Iowa successfully linking a progressive economic base with our enviable quality of life. We want to continue to work hand in hand with your chamber, our city, and county government to make Fairfield the place our kids want to come back to. Together, we can in 2001. And I'd like to also thank our staff of the chamber, our Executive Vice President Bob Phipps, Nancy, Melissa, as well. Thank you. Next, we have Jay Mitchell and Deb Davis presenting the Business Improvement Awards. Are you going to do this together or in shifts? We're doing it in shifts.
We'll try to make this short and sweet. Would the award winners please stand when introduced, and after the banquet, pick up your plaque, and please stay to have your picture taken so we can get pictures of everybody. Improvements to our downtown are always pleasant to see. Henderson Springs and Gallery put on a new storefront. They removed the large glass windows and replaced with thermal panes. The windows also have UV protection, which filters ultraviolet rays and allows them to display artwork without risk of fading. Don and Donna Henderson are here to accept the award. Don and Donna? Harper Brush added 27,000 square feet high cube warehouse space to their plant number 2 at 600 South 23rd Street. This has allowed them to consolidate back to 2 locations. The building has 5 dock doors and 1/2 mile storage racking. Here to accept the award is Jeff Harris, Industry Manager. Huff Financial Group added 2,000 square feet and remodeled their existing building, thus making available 2 conference rooms, 7 private offices, 2 working centers, private parking for 8 employees, which they currently have 7 full-time and 1 part-time, and parking for 8 customers. Huff Financial Group specializes in insurance and investment. Here to accept the award is partner Chad Huff. In the spring of 2000, construction began on a new entrance room for the Dandelion Cat, which matches the rest of the house, including the window trim inside. It's a perfect fit.
They put new light yellow siding on the exterior, which brightened the whole look of the house. They also added a ramp to the entrance, which provides easier access. Co-owner and operator, Patty Balderson, is here to accept the award. The Mighty Mart decided it was time to update this past fall. They improved the looks of the island and canopy. New covers and new lighting were put on the gas pumps. Lots of painting was done, with some new Conoco signage being added. They also did some changing around on the inside. Here to accept the award is owner Joanne Tice. Remodeling was done to accommodate the needs of the new Sears store, which opened this past year. They handle appliances, home electronics, hardware, and lawn and garden. They have 1 full-time employee and 6 part-time. Scott Ward, owner, is here to accept the award. Scott? And now for Jay.
I thought I was going to be able to share the stage with a beautiful woman. This is no good. We have to do this differently in the future then. All righty. Dollar Superstore. Our business was opened August 3rd of last year. We have 5 employees and carry a large selection of items, including health and beauty, party goods, balloons, candles, figurines, plastic goods, school items, toys and pet products, cleaning supplies, housewares, and a large selection of greeting cards, all for $1.19 or less. Accepting the award for Dollar Superstore this evening, local manager Shirley Rude and her husband Don. Are you here? Our next award goes to Godfather's Pizza and Sweets and Treats. The building was renovated on the inside with new counters, serving areas, flooring, and paint to create an intimate atmosphere. The kitchen was completely renovated for ease of service. What had been the bar area was turned into a specialty ice cream and candy store, and the exterior of the store was also updated. Accepting the award this evening for Godfather's Pizza and Sweets and Treats is owner Mark England and general manager Jerry Stroda. Hawthorne Direct is our next recipient. Hawthorne Direct, Inc., located at 300 North 16th Street, renovated an open 40-foot by 40-foot warehouse area starting in March of last year and ending in mid-September. The area now consists of four new offices and several rooms for our employees to use and enjoy on a daily basis, including a library room, a beautiful break room with full kitchen, lounge area with comfy couches and chairs. I'll be right over to test those out. TV and VCR and a conference room for company-wide and client functions with a state-of-the-art audio-video system. Accepting the award this evening for Hawthorne Direct is Vice President Bob Moore. You do look kind of comfy. That's good. Maharshi University of Management is a recipient of the Business Improvement Award this year. We've added 20,000 square feet of classroom and office space, 12 units of faculty and staff housing, and a new entrance road to the campus. And accepting for Maharshi University of Management tonight is Treasurer Michael Spivak. Michael? Red Rock Tavern is also receiving an award. We wanted to make it feel like an old English tavern, so we restored the metal ceiling and chose wood paneling with hunter green paint on some of the walls. We also installed new bathrooms and a new floor. There were a lot of other improvements, but those seemed to be the most interesting. It took us approximately 6 months to open. We'll be the judge of that, Jerry. It took us approximately 6 months to open. We plan on continuing with the old English look on the exterior in the spring. Now, Jerry Fisher, who was to accept the award, was called away and is not with us tonight. But let's recognize Jerry and Red Rock. T&T Auto Sales and Detail Shop. In addition to T&T's auto detailing and used car sales, this past year the company added a full line of car audio products, installation, and service, including car stereos, CD changers, amplifiers, and speakers from manufacturers from Alpine to Emerson. In addition, T&T has added other aftermarket products like neons, which I learned, and you soon will too, are the little lighted strips that go across the bottom of the sides of the cars, and remote starters, keyless entry systems, and alarms. And accepting the award tonight for T&T Auto Sales and Detail Shop, co-owner Josh Terrence. Josh? And I get the fun one also. That's all fun, of course. But this is an award that we especially like to give each year at the Chamber, and that's the Community Improvement Award. And this year's Community Improvement Award goes to Partners for Play. In August of 1999, a committee of local volunteers under the direction of Fairfield Park and Rec Director Barry Dodd began making their dream of a community-built playground a reality. With the help of local businesses and generous community members, approximately $150,000 in materials and money was donated. With more than 1,000 volunteers, the playground was built by all volunteer labor over a five-day period at the end of May of last year. How many participated in that? Was that a kick, or was that one of the most wonderful experiences of my life? And the playground, I think we all recognize, is a testament to the wonderful people of Fairfield, their ability to make a dream come true. We're very proud to be able to present this award this evening. And accepting for Partners for Play is Chairman Sarah Cochran. Sarah? You don't have to stand in place. You get to walk in place. So you get to come over. Do I have anything to actually give Sarah?
Just so it's not a hammer or a power
tool. Come on, Bob.
Gloves. Yeah.
Bob is over there taking a nap.
Don't worry, I only have 10 pages here.
Should never give her the microphone.
We're going to get you out of here by noon tomorrow. Absolutely the latest. Okay. Photo op.
Thanks, Jay. Jay asked me to send him a little something on what to say, and so I wrote him something and then said, oh, I don't know, maybe that's too schmaltzy, but he said, nah, schmaltzy are us. So a lot of what he said is very true. One thing I wanted to ask, he asked how many helped build, but I guess I would want to know how many in this room knew somebody who helped build, had employee help build, donated money, or in any other way participated, or knew somebody who did any of those things, because I'll bet it would be just about every single person in this room, which I think is one reason why this was such a wonderful project. I do want to recognize our committee, and I did have to write them down because I'm over 40 now, but just barely, Craig.
Okay.
So the Partners for Play committee consisted of Steve Cracker, Marty Gleason, Jennifer Anderson, Sally Hayes, Joe Carr, Lori Stever, Steve Lamb, Diane Messerly, Nancy Horace, Dave and Becky Graneman, Tim Lance, Cindy Burgraff, T.L. Henderson, Katie Schultz, Jane McMahon, Tammy Dunbar, Sue Long, Clarissa McMahon, Tom Stanley, Steve Winslow, Susan Booth, Pam Kraft, and Christy Leisure. Now, you know, that's not quite everybody in the city of Fairfield, but it was a pretty big committee, which is one of the reasons. They were a great group to work with, and I really hesitated given the names, because any committee I get on again, I'm going to use those people, so they're sort of my people. You can't use them. But they're a great group of volunteers. We had a lot of fun doing this, and I think that the people who came and helped build probably took away from the project maybe more than they even brought to it, if that's at all possible. It was a lot of fun. I would be remiss, though, if I didn't say thank you to the City of Fairfield for providing us with the perfect location for the playground. And I also want to say that our inspiration and much generosity was provided from the family of Matt Gomer, who the family adopted the project, and our playground is dedicated to him. And I'd also, let's see, what else didn't I say in here? Mm-hmm. Definitely a mighty thank you to all of the businesses who donated money and all of the people who donated their most precious commodity. I know it's probably my most precious commodity, and that's our time. Thank you very much. Enjoy the playground, and bring your kids, your grandkids, your friends, run around in it. I think this project was such a great show of what a community can do if we want to work together to help make it a better place to live here. Thank you.
I can say, Sarah, that in the years I've lived in Fairfield, I've never seen a project come together as quickly and in such a fantastic way that this project did pull together. It was something I remember when Sarah first came back to the office and was talking about this, I just kind of shook my head and thought, that'll never happen here. But it did, and it happened quick. And it was just truly amazing. It was a great thing for Fairfield, and it was something I wanted to mention in my opening remarks, but I knew this part of the program was coming, so I didn't, because it was something that I think all of us as a community can really be proud of. Moving on with the program, to present this year's Entrepreneur of the Year Award is Mr. David Neff. David?
I was asked by Ed Malloy, president of the Fairfield Entrepreneurial Association, to fill in for him, put in a plug for 1776 that he's a co-star working with at the 16th Street Theater. That's why he couldn't be here this evening. So I would be more than happy to share with you our Entrepreneur of the Year Award for this year. Lisco is the dream of Lance Yettersberger, a Fairfield resident from Canada. His vision of internet connectivity to rural communities began in 1995. Quote, we live in a small town We like living here, and we want to make it easier for our kids to remain here and have our local companies be in a position to compete and thrive, he says. So began the company, now known as Lisco. In a small office, alone with his computer and his wife, Bernie, sharing administrative responsibilities and funded on his own personal credit cards, Lance offered internet access to some of his friends in Fairfield. In the fall of 1995, Jerry Yellen joined the company and became director of marketing and a shareholder. Jerry responded to an inquiry about the internet from the public library in Centerville in early 1996. Shortly thereafter, Lisco offered internet access in that community. Today, Lisco offers internet access to 13,000 dial-up users in 100 small communities throughout southeast Iowa. DSL, high bandwidth access to cities that host POP in Washington, Burlington, Knoxville, Mount Pleasant, and wireless service right here in Fairfield. Lisco employs 31 people from Fairfield and the surrounding communities, all dedicated to bringing their talents to the Lisco team. Profitability, always an issue when starting a business, has increased proportionately to expenditures for resources, both personnel and equipment. To date, Lisco has geared up for expansion and puts back considerable amounts of money into both areas. This has given them a position of strength and the ability to take on projects that will enhance the value and profitability of the company, as well as service the communities. Those projects include wireless internet access, fiber optic installation, and telephone equipment sales. They contemplate offering video and e-commerce solutions for current and future customers of Lisco. All of these areas of business are in the planning stages. In the year 2000, Lisco, working on what could be considered the giant telecom industry to be a rather tight budget, Lance put together a fabulous array of state-of-the-art expensive telephone equipment and started a local telephone company called LTDS, Local Telephone and Data Services Corporation. Again, much in the fashion and success of Lisco, LTDS began offering telecommunication services in Fairfield at competitive, better prices than the local incumbent telephone company, and began employing more people in Fairfield and surrounding communities. At the moment, LTDS is carefully planning expansion into some of the small communities that offer Lisco internet access. We continue to expand our customer base, our employee base, and I am grateful for the opportunity that has been presented to me, Lance said after being sworn in as a United States citizen this past fall. Congratulations to the entire Lisco team. Our community grows in richness and vibrancy when entrepreneurs like Lance and Bernie put on their heart and their soul into the heart and soul of our community. Lance and Bernie, would you please come forward?
I'd like to, first of all, thank all the leaders of Fairfield. I think that we are very unique in Iowa and even in the country in terms of providing an environment that really encourages entrepreneurial development. I feel very fortunate to have come here, and I feel very honored to be part of this community and now a United States citizen. I'd like to personally thank all of you out there because many of you are customers and you were willing to go with us and provide our services, and we appreciate that, and we are looking forward to providing you with more and better services for this community and all the other communities we serve. I'd in particular like to thank our associates, Craig, who's our attorney, appreciate it, Darwin Sherwin, who worked with us from the very beginning with the newspapers. We very much appreciate that. And also the employees. It's kind of fun being in business because you really get to choose who you get to work with, and it's kind of like having your own Sandlot. And I've been very fortunate that the people that have come to LISCO, and it's really these people that deserve the honor for this award today, because I simply started out with an idea, and I was fortunate to gather around me people who are very capable in helping bring about the success of the internet. It was kind of delightful to hear people talk about the email that they're passing around now, because when I started, I went around to the community, some of the community leaders, to the library, suggesting that I would offer them some service, you know, as part of the community service that I was interested in. And everybody looked at me rather strangely, kind of, what is this internet stuff? So it's really come a long ways, and I think you'll find that the technology is going to continue to develop in ways that will make our communities a much more successful place to develop our businesses and for our young people to grow. We're very much looking forward to the development, the economic development of both Fairfield and Mount Pleasant with the new highways coming in. We're looking forward to developing fiber optic networks in both of those communities to enhance the telecommunications and really be a part of the economic development that's taking place in this part of the state between Cedar Rapids and Iowa City. And we think that our particular area is going to have a lot of advantages even over those areas, being that we're in a small town and it's going to be much more cost effective. So again, I'd like to thank all of you. I'd like to thank our customers, our associates, and certainly our employees. Thank you very much.
Is there anybody out there that really understands how the internet works? I mean, I'm not a car mechanic, not by any stretch of the imagination, but at least I can visualize how that works, you know, with the carburetor and the air and the fuel going into the cylinder and so forth. But how those little things happen on your computer, just totally beyond me. I'm glad there are some people around that have that understanding. Moving on with the program to help wrap up her year, Mrs. Nelson, I'd like to introduce Bev Nelson, last year's Chamber of Commerce President. Bev.
I have to have notes. Like Sarah, I'm over 40 now. I have to have notes. Isn't this Craig? Isn't he just a grin? I want you all to take a look at the bottom of your shoe because he lost his name tag around here someplace, and I'm sure somebody's walking around with it. So I do appreciate this time, and I really want to thank you for allowing me to be the president. It's been a wonderful year. Lots went on. I've had a marvelous board to work with, and I do want to just kind of wrap up with some of our goals and things that, you know, have taken place this year. Last year, our 2000 board retreat, we had 17 short-term goals and 17 long-term goals, and so we chose a few of the top vote getters, I guess, and we didn't use the CHAD system, just so you know. We just used little dots on the wall. Very simple. Maybe we should start electing people like this. I don't know. Anyway, so I want to tell you how we did this year. On our short-term goals, our number one goal was to get a sign or a canopy at the chamber building, because so many people, times we hear, you know, where is the chamber office located? Well, unfortunately, we were all set to do that, had kind of an idea picked out, you know, what we wanted and stuff, when we found out that the stability of our rental space might not really be there, so we put that on hold for now. The next thing was to resolve and work on the newsletter issue. We now send our newsletter weekly via email, and I'm with you, I don't know how it works, but it works really well. 3/4 of our membership now gets their newsletter that way, where another 1/4 get it by fax or mail. And this has drastically reduced our postage budget, as you can imagine. Sorry, any Mr. Postman. But you, as our members, are now getting your information much quicker and timely. And the credit for this setup and for the formatting of our email newsletter goes to Jay Mitchell and Melissa Kaufman. They worked many hours, or maybe it was days, to get this set up and to answer many members' questions because they couldn't open it and so forth. So those two have really done a terrific job. Another one of our short-term goals was our member surveys. This has just recently been completed through our website, and we don't even have the results all tabulated yet, so sorry about that. The marketing committee is working on that. And then there's our brick project, our Heritage Courtyard on the corner of 2nd and Burlington. And we were really worried there for a little bit. Were we going to get enough money for the sign? Because that was the first thing we wanted to get. We did raise enough money. And then what held us back was the company, and I believe it was North Dakota, couldn't find a piece of granite big enough for what we wanted. So that kind of set us back from our timetable. But then Kent Whitney and his guys just worked many, many hours of overtime to get the sign completed. And then Shouse Voorhees helped get it set. So it is a very beautiful sign. And I know everyone at the chamber is very, very proud of it. Now we need to just sell some more bricks so that we can get the first 1,000 bricks laid. We've had some very generous companies here in town buy bricks for all their employees, and those will be laid around their corporate brick. So this is phase one of the project, and we've already got people talking about what's phase two going to be, and we could do this for another phase. And so sometimes we just have to stop ourselves and say, this is a long-term project. We want this to be continuing for years. And so sometimes we just have to pull back the reins a little bit. But our hope is that we will have the first bricks laid this year. Follow-up to membership was a short-term goal, and we feel like we did a pretty good job with that. You learned about our goals last year. You'll learn about our new goals from Jody via the newsletter. You've been keeping up with the goals throughout the year. So then we realized communication is the ongoing issue. The sixth one was strengthening our members' benefit statement, and this is kind of in the works through our membership committee. We want to change some of the wording on some of our brochures and paperwork that go out to prospective members. Long-term goals. Number one, and you've heard this, is to develop a community festival with a lasting name recognition. This is still in the process. It's not obviously a short-term goal. We do have both a marketing committee and the events committee working on this. They've had numerous great ideas come through their committees. We are always looking for more help, whether it be ideas or manpower. And anybody that's interested in this, please let us know. Second long-term goal was establish Fairfield's entrepreneur capital, and the groundwork for this has been started by the FEA. FEA hosted a very successful e-commerce seminar this year, and we're constantly still getting calls about that conference and how we did it and information from that. Another one was unify the look of the chamber publications, and we do have a new logo. We kind of retired the gentleman and the boy from the square for our logo, and we've developed a more modern look. So as our publications need to be renewed or reordered, we're using our new logo. Another long-term goal, in which the staff is hoping is continuous long-term goal, is to increase salaries and benefits to the staff. As I told you last year, the chamber needs to keep up with what the going market is in the community. And so we're happy to say that the first step has been taken. We were able to give a little bit higher increase this year than we have in the past. And we also could add on to the health insurance benefit. Let's see, assist members with e-commerce education and links. And this is really an FEA issue that they're working on. They're doing a really good job with that, and this is also a long-term goal. And then there's a few other things. We just did a few other things, didn't we, board, this year? We had a very successful membership drive. We really got a lot of good new members. I see some of you are here tonight. We really appreciate that. We set up some new procedures for slow-paying members. It's one of those parts of business nobody ever wants to talk about, of course. Same with my husband's office. We don't want to talk about it there either. But we really did. We set up some procedures now that the staff and the next board can follow very simply. And seeing how I'm in the HR position, we now have job descriptions for our staff. So anybody that wants to know what the staff really does, we have it all written down now. And we also have some policies and procedures written down. So we kind of fine-tune some of the inner office proceedings. So really, overall, the board and the staff and I are really very pleased with everything that we accomplished this last year. The year went by so fast. I mean, just think, last year at this time, we were all wondering what we're going to do with all those jugs of water in the basement. One of our biggest items that happened this year, and it has been preceding this past few years, is our financials. We are really looking good at the moment. And with the instability of our office setting, that is really important too. And I just want to make this announcement that if we have any member that would like to rent the chamber space for $1 a year, please raise your hand. We want to talk to you maybe in the near future. I want to introduce our staff because they've worked very hard this year, and I'd like you guys to stand. Bob Phipps, Executive Vice President. Nancy Morrissey. And Melissa Kaufman. Melissa doesn't even take it to take a break, man. She's got to keep working right through this. Also, to my board of directors, thank you. Thank you. We had a really terrific year. We got a lot done. We had quite a few laughs as we went along, but I do appreciate your hard work and your dedication. Three of our board members are going off the board, and so I'd like to present, they're not all here, present at least one of them, a token of our appreciation. Kevin Tuohy is off the board now. He was treasurer this past year, and he was past president. Chris Bush is also going off the board. Neither one of those gentlemen are here. And I just want everybody to recognize that Chris Bush has been our membership chairperson for the last couple years and has done a marvelous job. He also helped with a successful membership drive and the dues collection. So Chris really has done a wonderful job. And then one of the board members that is going off is Roger Gay. And Roger's here. If you could come up. Roger's been on the board for 6 years. He's been active in our ag area of the chamber. He also has been instrumental in this new revitalization loan project that's all undergoing right now. Thank you, Roger, very much. And now one of the tougher jobs that a past president has to do, and I heard this from Jeff, and I heard it from Pat, and I heard it from Sarah throughout the years, and that's the President's Award. And this is a real tough one because so many people help you throughout the year, give you advice, answer your questions when you ask, when you pick up the phone and say, can you? They say yes. So this is a real tough one. The individual who assisted me in many ways this year, he's a terrific mentor, he's a good friend, and he's a wonderful volunteer for our community. He has a kind of a wacky sense of humor, and how he gets everything done that he's involved in is beyond me. I think that a lot of credit goes to his wonderful family and his staff at his office. He's helped me a whole bunch this year, and this award goes to, unfortunately, somebody that's not here. It's Dave Reif. So I guess kind of like at the Oscars, Dave's on location, and maybe somebody else will accept for him or something like that. But anyway, we will get that award. Her new board is presenting her with a large chocolate kiss because she's kind of a chocoholic.
Wow, that is a great way to get started. For those of you that know me, chocolate's pretty key in my life. So thank you, Bev, for that. And I want to also thank Bev for her year of dedication and hard work as well. I also would like to thank the staff, Nancy, Melissa, and Bob, for putting together the details of this banquet tonight. We had this wonderful idea to have a committee this year to help plan for the banquet, and I think if you happen to see a few more gray hairs or less hair, it's because we did this by committee. I think Bob was just like, man, what did he get us into? You know, he's used to, he knew exactly what needed to be done. So
you're dealing with this, Bob, and seeing us through this. I also would like to mention the board members and recognize them tonight. The board that I will be working with this year is a great group of people, and I want you to know who they are. So if you have anything you want to take to them, you can do that. I'll ask you each to please stand as I read your name and remain standing until we're all done. Jim Pedrick, President-elect. Steve Triplett, Vice President, Economic Development. Deb Davis, Vice President, Area Development. Devlin Wilson, Vice President, Public Affairs. Jane Mitchell, Vice President, Internal Affairs. Bev Nelson, Treasurer. And the directors, Susan Booth, Deb Carlson, Greg Hanshaw, Lisa Greening, Kim Ledger, Tim McCaleb, Bob Moore, Larry Smith, and John Siever. I'd like you to give them a round of applause. Well, Saturday, January 6th, we had our board planning session up in Pella. And it was, I think it was the most beautiful day of January we had, and there we were inside, but that's kind of the way it goes. We had some breaks so we could step outside and enjoy the nice, warm, sunny winter day. And David Vollmer was our facilitator, and he's the executive director of the Pella Area Chamber of Commerce. And we had great attendance that day. We had a lot of input by everyone that was there, and there was a lot of enthusiasm shown by the group. And so I guess I see that as my challenge, is to continue that enthusiasm to keep that going throughout the year. I thought I'd just talk and touch on a few of the goals that we set, because that basically is the agenda for the day, is to set our goals for the year. And most of you will have already, you know, read what the goals were that we set and the ones that we prioritized in an earlier edition of our newsletter that you received via email. And I might mention while we're on that email newsletter, for those of you that are getting it and reading it, great. Don't forget, though, to pass it on to everyone in your organization. I believe it just goes to one contact person, so you have to remember, you know, most of us have email systems within our offices or organizations, so try to forward that on. And if you're someone here that's not getting it, you need to find out who's getting it in your office so that you can get that. But anyway, a few of the ones I want to touch on, some of us have mentioned the top vote getters that day. Revitalization of the square, you know, it seemed to be very key, and everyone was enthusiastic about it and had a lot of discussion about what we might be able to do. Most recently, though, we announced a project called the Fairfield Revitalization Fund, and this is a fund that is available for businesses around the square and one block off. It was a joint effort of four local banks with the Chamber of Commerce to pledge a total of $1 million to be used for low interest loans, with a maximum of $50,000 for people to use to possibly remodel their building, their business, anything they might need to do to enhance the retail activity that they have or improve it. And not only to building owners, but to tenants as well, if they wanted to do some interior remodeling of the facility that they currently rent. And the overall goal of this fund basically is just to improve the downtown retail sector. And that's really become, you know, a lot of what I've heard already just in a little over a month that I've been president. You know, this is what is concerning people. So that is one thing that we have done to try to get that sparked and get some things going there. We also plan to continue to be involved in some joint efforts and to have meetings with the retail merchants of the downtown area and try to get their ideas and input about potential projects or changes that we could possibly make that might enhance the retail activity. You know, the whole success of this revitalization effort is really going to be a collaborative one, a collaborative effort by every party that's involved. It's city officials, it's retail merchants, it's the chamber, it's everyone. So we really do need everybody's input. This is not something, obviously, that we can just do alone. Another top goal that we had that day was new business attraction. And again, this is not only retail, because we want to continue to try to attract new businesses. There might be new retail businesses out there that are trying to find a place to locate. There may also be a retail business in a community that's relatively close by that's wanting to open up a second store. So we want to try to explore what we might be able to do to get those people to open up a store in Fairfield. We've passed this on just most recently at an executive board meeting to our community planning committee. And I might mention Steve Triplett. We have this problem with him leaving these meetings early. And every time he does that, we assign him something else. Steve is before Lawrence. So just even after the last meeting, I don't know if you've been informed of this. Yes, we've added something else. So anyway, just a word of the wise there if you tend to leave meetings early. This might keep you longer. So anyway, we want to get that committee together and get a chairman named and get them on the road and see what we can come up with. Also the Civic Center. That is a big project that obviously most of you are aware of that's going along in this community. And we want to be able to assist with the promotion of that facility as much as possible to try to draw new events to the area that maybe previously couldn't be held here due to space constraints of the current venues that we have. I can think of all sorts of things, and I'm sure you can too as well, that different shows and things that you hear about in communities nearby that we could have here in Fairfield if we have a larger facility. So we want to, have a presence in that activity and be sure that we promote that. And we really feel also that this type of a facility and the physical presence of it located nearby downtown will also be key in the revitalization efforts that we have for the downtown area and what we might be able to do there. So we're going to try to coordinate those efforts as well. The Highway 34 bypass, that's another issue that we talked a lot about, and it seems like a long ways down the road. The scheduled completion is at the end of 2004, but that will be here sooner than we know. And David Vollmer, again, our facilitator of Pella, he gave us some good insights into what we might do to do some early planning for that bypass in the Chamber of Commerce. Obviously, the project will go off as planned by DOT, but there are some things as a community that we need to be aware of, and we're going to try to do our best to educate ourselves and educate our members as to what we need to be prepared for, because we want to be prepared for the effects. And it was good to hear from him that actually the retail community in Pella did not have any negative impact. They felt that actually they had a positive impact of the bypass, which maybe hard for some of us to believe, but that was his remarks about what they had experienced. So again, we're very encouraged by that and hope that we can do what we need to do here so that happens in Fairfield. I'd just like to say that I basically share the same feeling as most of you in this room, that the Fairfield is a great place to live and work in, but as David Vollmer put it, we need to make Fairfield a destination. And for those that don't, for those that don't live here, so that they will come to Fairfield and stop and take part in an event or some activity that we have going on. And with the Chamber's efforts in revitalization, new business attraction, the Civic Center promotion and preparation for the bypass, we plan to do our part, to make that happen. And we hope that all of you will do yours as well and help us in our efforts. So thank you very much, and I'm looking forward to the year 2001. Recognize Bev as our past president. As she mentioned, and other people have mentioned, a lot was accomplished last year. And I know she spent many hours in meetings and hours at home working on projects, because I got some of those emails from her that were sent from home late at night and wee hours of the morning. So I know she was putting in a lot of time. She was very committed and enthusiastic in her leadership, and I want to thank her for that. And so Bev, we appreciate your efforts.
Thank you.
Tonight, it is our privilege to honor a man who is quite quiet, unassuming manner, has left his mark in this community in a variety of places. His life began almost but not quite 50 years ago in Western Iowa as the only son of two loving parents. He has four older sisters, a circumstance that would prepare him for later life. He arrived in Fairfield 24 years ago, quickly became involved in the Fairfield community. He joined the Fairfield JCs, serving many offices, including that of president. During his tenure with the JCs, he helped organize the initial city-wide 4th of July celebration at Waterworks Park. This tradition has continued to this day. Well past the time, he became too old to be a JC. However, he has still managed to annually satisfy his fireworks . He became a board member of the Chamber of Commerce, where he served 6 years, including 1 year as president. His friends remember him as the only chamber vice president who had to lip sync his predecessor's speech at the annual banquet. Serving as chamber president prepared him for his next volunteer project, chief coordinator for the Des Moines Register Ragbri Stay in Fairfield in 1988. Anyone who has worked on Fairfield Ragbri Committee can appreciate the immense size of this undertaking. When Ragbri returned to Fairfield in 1997, there were three co-coordinators. In July of 1989, he became a member of the Fairfield Public Library Board of Directors, where he continues to serve. He served as president of the Library Board from July 1992 to June 1995, a period when the board did the planning, fundraising, and started construction of the new Fairfield Public Library. As a board member, he was actively and directly involved with several major benefactors who helped make the dream of a new facility a reality. This new building was a culmination of long-range planning that became when our recipient came on the board. With the dedication of many hours of hard work from our honoree and others, Fairfield can proudly boast of having one of the finest libraries of this area. To help ensure the continued financial well-being of our library, he played a major role in the creation of the Fairfield Public Library Foundation. Our award winner also served as a judicial magistrate in Jefferson County from 1974 to 1994. In this capacity, he performed a variety of unique marriage ceremonies at various times and places. With a little help from his friends in honor of his 40th birthday, he came within minutes of unknowingly performing Iowa's first same-sex marriage. However, his eagle eye and quick mind determined something was amiss. He has been extremely active in his church and is currently serving his third term in the First Lutheran Council, Church Council. He has also served as president of the Church Council two times and regularly serves as usher, worship assistant, and communion assistant. And he is a longtime member of the Sanctuary Choir. Our award winner has also served on the board of the Fairfield Golf and Country Club for 6 years, including a year as president. In recent years, he helped establish the Chamber of Commerce Relations Committee and served on the County Jail Task Force. In spite of all these community activities, our award winner does manage to find time to play a few, but not enough, rounds of golf, a game he truly enjoys and in which he excels. He also enjoys spending time as a volunteer girls basketball coach, something he has done for the past 9 to 10 years. In addition to helping girls develop basketball skills, this provides him with an opportunity to occasionally use his patented phrase, "Aw, come on," when questioning an official's bad call. This is a phrase he created and was known for when he played in the Fairfield Men's Recreation Basketball League. Our award winner's journey to Fairfield started in Atlantic, Iowa, where he graduated from high school in 1969. He then attended and graduated from Dana College in Blair, Nebraska in 1973. From Dana, he ventured to law school at the University of Iowa, where he graduated in 1976. staying close to his beloved Hawkeyes, he landed in Fairfield after obtaining his law degree. He and his wife, Jamie, are the proud parents of five girls. Kelly, a junior at Dana College, Dana, a freshman at Simpson College, Kirsten, a junior at Fairfield High School, and twin daughters, Amanda and Jennifer, seventh graders at middle school in Fairfield. As you may recall, having four sisters older prepared him for one of his really big accomplishments, surviving in a house with six women. Fortunately, the golf course is just across the creek. Won't you please join me in congratulating Fairfield Citizen of the Year, Tim Kuyken.
Try and make this brief. But I did notice that the sound wasn't all that good. Was this helping any? I'm not sure it's doing anything. In any event, this was a surprise because I was led here by somebody saying, well, somebody else in the office is getting this sort of thing, which I thought was wonderful. Didn't take very long, though, when they started talking about Western Iowa, because then I knew it wasn't Myron, since he was a local boy. But I do appreciate the award. Living with six women, never so often they pull a fast one on me, and I think Jamie did that again this time. But I will say this, it's been an interesting and very, very rewarding almost 25 years in this community. I've lived in this community longer than I've lived anyplace else, and I wouldn't trade that opportunity to live in a community like this and friends that I have in this community and the family that I have in this community. I wouldn't trade it for anything. So, thank you very much. And somebody else can have this.
Break, break, break. Maybe you weren't talking loud enough.
I'll put that one in there.
We're standing by.
You can be like me and not have no microphone.
You got it in the right.
When BS
way,
speaks,
Brett. You got it in the right.
Yeah, right. Right there.
Yep. Positive on the right side.
Bob.
Let me sit this way.
Yep. Anyone care to lead a song?
No.
Trust me, you don't want to
do this. There you go.
There you go. Try that.
All right. Talking? Okay. Actually, this microphone works fairly well for someone who's my height or thereabouts, but Tim comes up here, he's in a different level, of course, and this thing really doesn't even adjust. It's just kind of in a permanent disposition, so it's just the way it is. I guess to follow up, we have the better-looking member of the Elderberry Boulevard tag team, Mrs. Johnine Parker.
I'm not messing with the microphone. I just want the rest of you to know. And since I'm over 40, but just barely, I'll get my glasses on. This year's outstanding female citizen has a tradition of quietly and unassumingly going about her life sharing her many gifts and talents to our community. She comes to us with a rich Iowa heritage. She was reared along with two brothers on an Iowa farm in a county which starts with the letter M. While growing up there, she was always very active in her schools, most notably in her high school drama and vocal music programs as well as in her community. In 1972, she graduated from Iowa State University with a degree in fashion merchandising. It was there that she was to meet her future husband on the red eye shift at Friley Hall. On a sunny but cold March 1773 day, they were married. He imported her to a farm in Jefferson County, and are we ever glad. After moving here, she worked with Indian Hills Community College as adult education coordinator, with an area bank, the sewing room, and always for her church. This woman is deeply devout and pledged to her church. She has served many offices in the Lutheran Women's Missionary League. Her primary foci here are support of missions and missionaries and support of the young people in her church with scholarships. She is a four-year chairman of the Board of Education, and this is a big job because this church provides some very special services to the community. She is director as well as a substitute teacher for her church's Mother's Day Out programs. Her programs guide, nurture, and love our community's children who are fortunate to attend. In her preschool programs, there are 10 3-year-olds, 24 4-to-5-year-olds, and 12 pre-kindergartners. Many families are touched and very positively served by these programs. She's a choir member, past Sunday school teacher, and a strong steward of her church's major building project. If you want to see, just drive by it on Highway 1 South. In the mid-80s, she came home to the farm to be a mom and developed a vegetable production program. She's filled many a local as well as a distant tummy with her asparagus, broccoli, sweet corn, and zucchini. Now imagine, folks, 1 acre of zucchini. You know, here in Iowa, at least where I live, we always say it's the only time of the year we lock our cars, and that's for fear someone will leave some more zucchini. All this has evolved to her currently famous pumpkins. She and her family grow 8,000 to 9,000 pumpkins every season. She also provides all the other fun fall items such as gourds, Indian corn, mums as well. She really has a talent for decorating too. Drive by her farm and see all the artful displays which she personally creates. Her hospitality welcomes all, and you can browse at your leisure. Everything is on the honor system. Just drop your coins in the can, no questions asked. And don't forget the holidays. She's known for her beautiful Fraser firs and provides about 250 of them each season. She personally decorates and puts her special touches on about 75 evergreen wreaths, and all these grace our area homes and businesses each December. Are they ever beautiful? Now, all this is not too bad for someone who said, "I'm never going to marry a farmer." She spent 3 years on the State Farm Bureau's Young Member Committee helping to educate and promote agricultural issues. She really developed her current legislative savvy during this time. She also spent 2 years as a speaker for the State Farm Bureau Speakers Corps, again promoting Iowa agriculture. She's a 4-year member and current president of the Greater Jefferson County Foundation during times of tremendous growth. This foundation has seen a 4-fold growth in its resources with a current net value of nearly $3 million. The foundation's superlative scholarship program has tripled during her time on the board. If you need more information about this board, just ask her. I know she'll be glad to tell you. She's a 5-year member and currently president of the Jefferson County Hospital Board of Trustees during times of rapid change and huge challenges in healthcare. She's helped guide the local hospital through the recruitment and selection of a new CEO. She's had to strive to become educated about all the demands, including community needs, government and third-party payer issues, and budget concerns placed upon our healthcare providers today. She has steered our local healthcare institution through a complete strategic planning process. These are not small tasks. As if she didn't have enough to do, for the last 15 years, she's welcomed busloads of children to her farm. She sponsors approximately 6 field trips per week, each week in the month of October. Each child visits her great pumpkin patch, and everyone leaves with a pumpkin of his or her own, basketball size or smaller. Want to be a bus driver, huh? For all these contributions, we thank her. This woman is intelligent, she's motivated, strong, resourceful, delightful, and a genuine person. I'm sure that Walter and Adele Dietrich of St. Ansgar knew early on the treasure that they had in this daughter. Please join her husband, partner, and best friend Norman, and son Jeremy, a sophomore at Iowa State University, in recognizing this year's outstanding citizen, Dorian Marie Atwood.
I think Johnny knows how to tell a story. I am very surprised and deeply honored to accept this award, and also a bit embarrassed, because I know that anything I've done has only occurred because of the great people who have been there to help me. Mother's Day Out has been something that has been dear to my heart. Reaching the preschool population of our community. But it's only successful because of the people who work there, the wonderful teachers we have, the wonderful staff that we have that support them. The Greater Jefferson County Foundation is a wonderful organization that I have been privileged to serve. When I first came on, I didn't have a clue what it was really all about. And yet, I've met wonderful people. Dr. Bauman, who is our financial committee chairman, Tom Kunkel, who works with our grants, Art Hutton, who works with our scholarships. Everyone does their job, and it's made my job very easy. Also, the hospital is an organization that I've really come to appreciate with working with them, with people whose job is not just a job to them, but part of their mission. That they do their job, and it's amazing what is happening in healthcare, and to see everyone working together, whether they're the people who greet you at the front desk, or the ones who help you when you're in the hospital, or the physicians that care for you. We are very fortunate to have these people working with us. I'd like to thank my husband Norman and my son Jeremy. Both of them have given up a lot of their time. They've had to have a lot of meals by themselves without me there, or interruptions with telephone calls. I love them very much. And I guess that's why I do what I do, because I love this community. I love what you guys have done to help make it a place that I've enjoyed. I hope that I can just give back a little bit to the community, what you have given me. That we can make this a place that our kids want to come back home to. Thanks a lot.
I hope all of you share the same feeling that I have right now, and that is that I hope all of you recognize what a great, wonderful community we have to live in, and what great, wonderful people we have here. To all of those who received awards tonight, you have my congratulations, and the community thanks you for all of your efforts. Bev, I'd like to thank you for the terrific job you did as president. You're just a high-energy person, and you did a great job with a lot of enthusiasm, and that's something that when you're leading an organization that's full of volunteers, that's something you have to have, is a lot of enthusiasm. A couple of other housekeeping things. On the table, there's a folder from Fox 15. It's my understanding that if you have a gold star in the folder in front of you, that there's a gift
that'll be out in the lobby, Bob, is that right? No, Andy Nelson has them? Okay. I would also like to take this opportunity, and maybe this is somewhat like the preacher preaching to the choir, but I'd like to encourage all of you who are not involved with the chamber or who haven't been involved for a few years to try to find some time and give some time to the chamber. The Chamber of Commerce does a great job helping hold this community together and to help it be better, a better place for all of us. I would also like to remind those award winners to stick around after we adjourn this evening. I think there's some photo ops that would need to be taken care of. And before closing, for those of you that aren't in my office, you obviously wouldn't have a reason to know this, but just as a reminder, Tim, there is that office tradition that anyone in the office who gets an award or wins a prize treats. So.
Peggy's bringing a cake.
Ooh. So I'll be skipping breakfast on Monday. I'd like to encourage everybody to remain for the entertainment this evening. We do have the sound company. Cheryl Payne and Jim Collett are providing entertainment. They were providing the music beforehand, and we'll be providing music until 10:30 this evening. I'd like to have you support them. Jim, of course, does this in the wintertime. He needs the money to support his golf habit in the summertime. So, especially the money he loses on the golf course. But thank you all for coming. We hope you had a great time, and hope to see you again next year. Thank you.